Hello everyone, in this video I'm going to show you how to set up a simple Elastic Beanstalk application using PHP. To do that, once you have logged into AWS console, go to Elastic Beanstalk services. To do that, you can click on services and you should be able to find Elastic Beanstalk right under compute, or you can filter it in the search bar. So just type Elastic Beanstalk and you can navigate to the service. Now you can see that this is the welcome page. I do not have any applications or environments configured, so you can do a quick start of your application, sample application, by selecting a platform from this drop down. But I'm going to run you through step by step process of how to do that. So let us go ahead and create a new application from scratch. So now once you do that, you'll get a certain steps to create your application and an environment in it. So let's go ahead and create this. So we'll say something like OSFG web server. So OSFG is open source for geeks, which is my blog. So let's name it OSFG web server, and let's just copy the same thing to the description. We'll do next. So now at this point your application is created. Now you need to create a new environment inside this application. So you can either choose a web server environment, which is your basically an HTTP or HTTPS web server, right, that you host on cloud, whereas work environment is more of a component that can be used to decouple your actual web server. So let's say you have some asynchronous task. So your web server receives requests from the client and puts the items into an SQSQ, then your worker environments can pick those up and process it asynchronously. So that is what worker environment is, but for this demo we are going to select a web server environment. So let me go ahead and click create web server. Now inside that you need to choose what kind of environment do you want this Elastic Beanstalk to host. So as we saw before, these are the type of applications you can host. So for simplicity sake, I'm going to choose PHP because that's the simplest to demo. And environment type is another interesting thing to note. So you can either say it's a single instance, which will just spin up a new EC2 instance, or you can say it your environment is behind a load balancing and auto scaling system. So this means that you will have a load balancer in front and you will have multiple EC2 instances based on your auto scaling policies, and whenever a client requests for your web server resources, your load balancer will kind of redirect the request to one of the EC2 servers that are running behind the auto scaling group. So let's keep that and let's click on next. Now once you do that, you can either deploy your own application or you can let sample application run. So we will deploy our own code in some time, but to start with, let's use the sample application. Next option is to choose your deployment preferences. This is when specifically when your application is behind an auto scaling group. So your code is basically deployed to two or three EC2 instances, depending how you have configured the auto scaling group. So you can choose how do you want your new code to be deployed. So it can either be rolling, or you know, basically deploy everything to all the EC2 instances at once. So I'll keep it rolling for now, and what I'm gonna do is, instead of percentage, I'm gonna say fixed. So let's say you have three EC2 instances, your deployment will just pick one EC2 instance at a single time, deploy your new code there, and so on and so forth, right? And a load balancer will figure out that some EC2 instance has gone down. It will redirect the queries to the other EC2 instances that is yet to be picked up for deployment. So let's keep this settings like this and click on next. Now next you need to choose to create an environment. So once you create an application, you can create an environment. So environment is basically something like a dev environment, a QA environment, and a production environment. So let's just name this dev for now, which is dev environment, and this is the URL, environment URL that gets generated. So you can click on check availability and it looks like it is available, so we'll stick with this. And let's keep description as empty and click on next. Now you can configure additional resources here. One is you can configure a relational database, and you can also choose to put your EC2 instance inside your own custom VPC. But one important thing to note here is that if you create an RDS instance from here, then when you delete your environment or your application, this RDS database will get deleted as well. So to avoid this, what general practice is that you create a RDS instance separately, and then once you do that, you can link it later with your Elastic Beanstalk application. So I'm just gonna keep these as default. I'm not gonna change this, and click on next. Now you can choose what type of EC2 instance do you want to spin up to deploy your code. This is a free tier account, so I'm gonna stick to t2.micro, but if you have kind of production needs, then you should probably go with type of instances that are down at the bottom of this drop down. So I'll stick with t2.micro. EC2 key pair, so if you want to SSH into your EC2 instances, make sure you select your EC2 pair. I'll just choose my web server key, which I have. You can give email addresses if you want to receive notifications of your deployments and other in general notifications from Elastic Beanstalk. These are not mandatory, so I'm just gonna skip it. Again, you have health check URLs, so your Elastic Load Balancer checks this URL to see whether your EC2 instances are down or not. So we are going to keep this as blank as well for now, but it is highly recommended that you add something like /health.htm or /test.htm and make your web server render some page, some response to that particular URL, and that way ELB knows that your EC2 is healthy. Rolling updates type, rolling based on health, which is fine. So next is cross zone load balancing. So the way load balancing works is that, first of all, load balancing only works in a particular region, so it does work cross AZ, which is availability zones, but it is still inside a single region. So let's say you have deployed your Elastic Beanstalk environment in two AZs in a single region, let's say AZ1, AZ2, and let's say AZ1 has 4 EC2 instances and AZ2 has 2 EC2 instances, then all the requests that come to load balancer will be equally distributed to AZ1 and AZ2, which means that the number of requests received by 4 EC2 instances in AZ1 are same as the requests received by 2 EC2 instances in AZ2, right? Which is clearly not optimizing the load balancing. However, if you want to equally distribute load across all the 6 EC2 instances across the AZs, then you need to choose this option, which is cross zone load balancing, and in that case ELB will equally distribute the load to 4 and 2 EC2 instances in each AZ. Next option is connection draining. So connection draining, so generally how ELB works is that when ELB notices that your EC2 health is bad, it will replace it with another EC2 instance if you have it behind auto scaling group. But it basically identifies whether your EC2 is healthy and it can serve your request. So if you mention connection draining, then what it will do is, even though it figures out that the EC2 instance is not healthy, it will keep the connection alive so that the requests that are already gone to that EC2 instances get a chance to get completed. However, the new requests do not go to that EC2 instance. So that is what connection draining is, and the requests that are already made to EC2 instance will get a timeout of whatever you configure here, which is 20 seconds to complete. However, if this timeout occurs, then ELB will, which is load balancer, will forcefully terminate the connection. So I'm gonna keep these as default as well, but I hope you understood what these settings are. These are kind of very important. Other than that, I'm gonna keep other things as default. You can choose the type of root volume. If you want a higher throughput, I would suggest go for provisioned IOPS. If not, then you can go for general purpose SSD. Magnetic is HSD, so I would suggest not to go for this. You could either go for general purpose SSD or provisioned IOPS. So I'm just gonna keep it as default and click on next. So here you can add tags. I just prefer adding admin, Thakur, and maybe environment as dev, and let's click on next. So this is service roles and instance profiles. So if you have created specifically a service role, then you can add it here. I'm just gonna keep it as default. This is basically the Elastic Beanstalk service that has created this profile and roles for us. So let's keep that as default and click next. Now once you do that, you would get a summary of what settings you have selected. Just go ahead and create launch. Now once you do that, you would see that your Elastic Beanstalk environment is getting launched. So what it will do is it will create an Elastic load balancer, it will create an auto scaling group, and your Elastic load balancer will kind of point to your auto scaling EC2 instances behind the auto scaling group. So you can go to configuration here and you can see what are the settings that you have applied. So you can see it is load balancing, number of instances are 1, 2, 4. You can actually go ahead and edit this. You won't be able to edit it now since the environment configuration is in progress, but you can go ahead and edit it later. So it says minimum instance count is 1, maximum instance count is 4, and your EC2 instances will be hosted in any of this availability zones, or you can choose one of these, right? And scaling triggers, you have network out, you can generally go with CPU utilization. So if CPU utilization is above a particular percentage of threshold, you can choose that, but let us not change anything at this point of time. So since this is getting started, I'll show you the EC2 instance as well. There should be an EC2 instance that should be getting run right now. There we go, I see one instance already running. So you can see that the name is OSFG web server dev. So this is the EC2 instance started by our Elastic Beanstalk. It is still initializing and deploying our code. So that is the EC2. Let's quickly check at ELB as well, which is, oh sorry, it is a part of EC2 itself, so you should be able to see it here. There we go, load balancers, and we should be able to see a load balancer here. There we go, you can see a load balancer is created in a default VPC, and let's see some of the configurations here. So this is the ELB, it is in default VPC, and you can see it is serving one of one instance in service. So because our auto scaling had minimum of one EC2 instance, we just have one EC2 instance, and your ELB is redirecting all the requests to that EC2 instance. So you can click on instances and see that this is the instance that we just saw before in the EC2. So if you have, let's say, two minimum instances in the auto scaling group, then you would probably have two here, and your Elastic load balancer will basically redirect traffic to both of the EC2 instances. But for now, since we just have one EC2 instance, this is just one. So you can have a health check and all other configurations here. Like for example, currently ELB is configured to have just HTTP traffic, but you can configure it to add HTTPS traffic as well, provided you have correct SSL certificates. So if you have your own DNS configured from Route 53, you can generate your own SSL certificate for your domain and add an HTTPS listener here. So all those stuff you can do. So let's go back to our Elastic Beanstalk. And as you can see, this is the application, and our dev environment is up and running. So let's go and click inside it, and you can see this is the URL that it is pointing to. So if you click and open a new tab, you can see a default PHP configuration is up and running, right? Which means you have successfully deployed your Elastic Beanstalk PHP application on AWS. So I would end this video here, but in the next video I'm going to show you how to deploy your own code to this and how to see that up and running. So thank you, stay tuned.